Your story, though, is such a Kalgoorlie success story.
To all you young guys, she's getting married in April.
These guys that went to school together, primary school together, have stayed friends their whole lives, you know, but they did used to get into a lot of mischief.
And if there were more Ron Sayerses around in Australia, we'd be a better country for it.
If I can swear for a moment.
No, I wasn't inviting you to do that.
We've had a lot of fuck-ups, don't we?
Ron Sayers, or Bully as us grand kids called him, was diagnosed with cancer on the 31st of March 2022. As a final tribute to the man who made our lives whole, I decided to create a documentary, one he could watch to know how great he was and how much we loved him. To begin this documentary, I decided to start with his sister.
I'm Colleen Swiderski. Ron is my brother, and he was born in May 1952. And I was born in May 1954. Our parents were Tom and Faye. Dad was a guard on the Commonwealth Railways for many years, and Mum was a stay-at-home mum. Very popular. Ron was really popular at school, and he had very close friends, like friends that he made at school, he still has today.
You had to endure polio at the age of four, which earned you the nickname Wobbly. Yep. As a kid, somewhere along the way it changed from Wobbly to Tanglefoot. I'm not sure if there's another story there. You know, your dad was a guard on the railways, Mum was a bit of a tennis player. You grew up with schoolmates that later became, you know, your business partners and lifelong friends. Kalgoorlie's obviously been a special place for you.
It certainly has. And I said it with my heart when I said, thank God I was born in Kalgoorlie.
With Ron's polio, it limited him a little bit, but it never stopped him from participating in every sport. He was an excellent tennis player. He rode racing bikes. So it never ever deterred from him, but he did have a limp that stayed with him. I was 9 and Ron was 11. Ron was in Perth playing in a tennis tournament, and I was staying with my auntie Kath when Dad came to tell us that our mother had left. Ron was then sent to boarding school and I was sent to live with relatives.
Competing in tennis tournaments were youngsters at the time. And when I came home, I was expecting my mother to meet me at the train station. She wasn't there. And I'm looking around and I'm worried, where's my mother? And then my father appeared, and I said, where's Mum? He said, I'll tell you, get in the car. So we get in the car, and we're driving home. I said, where's Mum? He said, son, she's gone. I said, what do you mean gone? He said, she has gone, she's left us. And the only way I can explain it, if you don't feed the chooks, they fly over the fence. Because he worked on the Commonwealth Railways, he was away 5 or 6 days a week. She found another partner.
It was such a shock for us because it all happened so quickly. Like one week, one moment we're living in our house in Bourke Street, the following week the house was sold practically. And we just got separated. Mum and Ron were very, very close. They had a great relationship. When she left, he was absolutely devastated and he never ever got over it. Him and Mum built up a relationship again over the years when Mum moved back to WA. But I always felt that he never ever forgave her. When Ron came back from boarding school, he used to hate boarding school because he hated eating vegetables.
And then I then went to New Norcia.
You went to New Norcia.
My father sent me there.
Because he still had to work, right?
Because it worked. It was a college, Benedictine monks, which were a little different, but it worked.
And, it worked? And until it didn't work.
Until it didn't work, and I used to come home.
He said, I'm not going back.
I'd come home on the train, and the last time I went, I'd had enough. And it all went back to the feed that they gave us. And I hate vegetables, and they used to make me eat them all the time. So in the finish, I said, "Dad, I'm not going back." He said, "You are." I said, "I'm not. If you put me on the train, I'll get off in Coolgardie and walk home." So where are we going now? He said, "Get an apprenticeship." And that's how I finished up being here. I needed an apprenticeship to get him off me back.
You also needed to be 15 to enrol in that apprenticeship too, didn't you, Ron? You're only 14, but you just fudged the number.
I fudged my number and I got an apprenticeship.
And that's how he started working at the Great Boulder. With Ron and Dad, they had a really good relationship. But the only thing is, Ron put Dad on such a pedestal, it was a big thing for Dad to fall. Ron was involved in a really bad car accident when he was 9, and she's dragged him about 100 metres up the road, and Ron was injured very badly. In fact, a lot of people thought he had died. He was in hospital for about 3 months, I think, but he recovered. The resilience in that kid, he was just, the things that happened to him in his life, he just got on with it, you know. With all Ron's injuries and everything else in his life, he was a very good sportsman. He was an A-grade tennis player, won heaps of trophies. He played football. He wanted to play cricket for North Kalgoorlie School or something. Then got into bikes and cars, so sports stopped then. In the past year, our mum lives in a nursing home and she has dementia. She's now 89 years of age and still calls herself Flying Faye. And Ron, in the past year, has also been diagnosed with Alzheimer's.
And the humour of the gold mines, I got an apprenticeship at the Great Boulder Gold Mine, which is now one of the main parts of the super pit. But that all went pretty well. And where was I?
Super pit.
Yeah, the super pit.
That's all right.
So he's coping, and he coped very, very well, but he's struggling a bit.
After talking to his sister about his childhood, I decided to talk to Bob Leatham, someone Bully worked under for 6 years.
I first met Ron when I came to Australia. I came to Australia in 1980. Ron worked for a company called Compare in Kalgoorlie in 1980, and I came to run the mining division of a company called Compare that Ron worked for. And he was in Kalgoorlie, I was in Melbourne, and I ran the Australian operations. So Ron worked for me for 6 years. From September 1980, I first met Ron, and from then on, we hit it off. And it was incredible how well we got on. First impressions I ever have of Ron was how hard he worked and how hard he played. And it suited me down to the ground because I liked that idea. And I was the best man at his wedding when Lynn and Ron married. And I said to Lynn, Ron's got two speeds, 100 miles an hour or stop. Just hang on when he's going at 100 miles an hour because you'll have a lot of fun. But when he stops, he goes straight to sleep. Ron was having a lot of success selling Tamrock equipment, and he was selling track drills to Bobby Baker, who ran Hi-Tech. And Bob was starting to get work here, there, and everywhere. And every time Ron would catch up with Bob, Bob would buy another Ferrari.
And the top salesman in the country at one point, no less.
Yeah.
But there was a moment when you realised that selling them was one thing, but maybe owning them was a better idea, right?
Yes. Well, there was a guy in Kalgoorlie called Bobby Baker. He ran a company called Hi-Tech Drilling. And he used to have Gardner Denver pneumatic machines. Anyway, one day he turned up at my place and said, I'm interested in one of those hydraulic machines. So I said, not a problem. Went and got a good deal done, sold him the machine. And before you knew it, he had 3, 4, 5 hydraulic machines. And then I went round to his house one day, and he had 3 Ferraris in the driveway. And I said to him, I said, hey, Bob, what's with the Ferraris? He said, one's mine, one's the wife's, and one's the son's. I said, oh, yeah. There's got to be more money in using them than selling them. So I hopped my house and bought a second-hand rig and went and got a job at the Super Pit in Kalgoorlie, where we're still there 30-odd years later. And
they started drilling, he got contracts, and one thing led to another. And now the way that it developed was incredible. But as Ron says all the time, he was in the right place at the right time. He was in Kalgoorlie when the mining industry took off, and he fitted right in. Ron and I were going to Ghana, and we flew into Accra together, and we didn't have a visa because at that stage we didn't think we needed a visa. And we both got arrested because we didn't have a visa. We got arrested, and then they gave us the opportunity. We were to be put on the next plane out of Ghana, and it happened to be a plane to London. So we were escorted out to the plane under armed guard with machine guns and given our passports only when we got on the plane. When we arrived in England, I said to Ron, well, what are we going to do? He said, well, let's hire a car and drive around a bit. Have a look, there's no point, we can't go back to Ghana. So we did, we hired a Jaguar and we drove up the motorway and we had a few drinks and we decided to go back. As Ron used to say, if you see a guy who you think would be good for the company, hire him and then find him a job. Not wait until you have a job coming up and then try and find somebody to fit it. And he was already always ready for a laugh. That was the other good thing. He always enjoyed himself. He always made people smile. People saw Ron, they smiled. They couldn't help themselves.
Got some water?
No, I'm right. Yeah. I've got a beer somewhere.
Ron passed away. You've got me stumbling. Ron passed away in May this year, 4 days after he turned 70. It was a shock because you can't imagine him being the person he was to lose him.
We lost Bully to his fight with cancer. Despite being told that we would have 3 to 6 months, he was gone within 5 weeks. We miss him. I just wish he knows how much we loved him. Despite not getting to see this documentary, I've decided I'm going to continue.
But I feel like Google One, I can take my Google One badge off now because he would ring me all the time. Who's this person? What's this person do? Where's this? Where's that? You know, and I didn't mind. Even if it was 3 o'clock in the morning, when he thought of something, he would ring because he'd want answers. And that's what I miss. I miss that.
Oh, there's no question what I miss the most about him is I'm driving home after work every night. First phone call I get as I left work or before I left work would be him ringing me and saying, you're dropping off for a drink on the way home. Yeah, that phone call on the way home is probably the thing that I miss the most because I drive home from work every night and think of the same thing.
He talked to people about everything. He would make 6 phone calls in 20 minutes and everybody would be pleased to listen to him or hear from him. And that's what I miss most. My phone don't ring now. I could throw my phone away because Ron's never, it was the most pleasant thing. That if Ron rang, you know you were in for a bit of a laugh. And that was the thing I miss most.
I had the alarm bell as Ron's ringtone, and when it rang, I would leap over anything, knock you out of the way to make sure I answered the phone because Ron was ringing and he had everyone on their toes all the time. So when he rang, which was often multiple times a day, he kept you on edge. You're always on the edge of the seat. And I drive around now or get around now and I feel like I'm sort of, it's almost surreal. It feels like life's just slowed down a touch without him here because he was constantly keeping us going at 100 miles an hour and keeping us on edge.
It's also some sad news since we last spoke, the passing of Ron Sayers, who I believe you're somewhat close with.
Yeah, sad loss for so many in the goldfields. He was a great goldfielder, a typical Kalgoorlie way. He started as a mechanic on the Great Boulder, on the Golden Mile, ended up running one of the world's biggest drilling companies. But the great thing about Ron is you never knew the difference, and he never forgot where he came from.
He meant a lot to me, Ron. He meant a lot to a lot of people. He was an enigma. You know, he was something different. He was one out of the box. And not only, I'm not the only person that thinks that, everybody thinks that.
He would have to be the most loyal, caring fella that you ever wish to meet.
Ron was always like that. He was always there for you. He always wanted to help. If you had a problem or an issue, he'd work out a way of fixing it, assisting you, helping you. Yeah, he never changed.
I know that movie Dumb and Dumber, where they say, one in a million, so there is a chance. And Ron was that, he was typical, that epitomised Ron. If you could tell him there's a one in a million chance of something happening or working, he'd be like, okay, so we've got a chance. So he was just always, say, glass half full. It wasn't even half full, it could be only a tiny bit full, but he was ever the optimist. And if you said something couldn't work, he'd try and set out to prove you that he could make it work. He was just a man with never say never and such a can-do attitude, which is just incredible.
Oh, Ron was a great influence on my life. I mean, having known him from the Cambelda days, and his ability to sell equipment and provide assistance when in times of need, all the way over to the times we raced horses in Kalgoorlie together, and then when we moved here to Perth, and we bought the property next door. Oh, look, I don't think there was any one single influence that Ron sort of. It was just a lot of influences over many, many years. My favourite memory would have been the time that me and him jumped in a semi-trailer and drove from here to Melbourne. We left Yarradale, drove out the front gate, and the spare tyre fell off the back of the truck. For the next, I think it took us 5 or 6 days to get to Melbourne, because we only drove during the day. We just had just the greatest time all the way over. I mean, we laughed and... We won two Cox plates in consecutive years with a horse called Northerly. The first year, all the other owners went to Melbourne for the Cox plate, but we couldn't go because Ron's daughter Christy was getting married.
I'd just like to mention three of our co-owners who unfortunately aren't here today because of a family wedding, but I'm sure that it's just made the wedding so much better.
Side from Viscount, Sunline the leader, Northerly on the outside, and Viscount coming at her, Sunline in front, Northerly the outside going to Sunline. They got very tight, but Northerly wins the Cox plate. A half length to Sunline, who was tight and close to the line.
Of course, when the Cox plate was about to finish, we all had to jump in the cars and head to the wedding, and it just happened to be that there was a protest. But the second or third horse protested against the winner, and that took quite some time. So we had to sit around the lounge room at Yarradale waiting for the result of the protest. And of course, that probably put Christy at least half an hour late for her own wedding. But under no circumstances was Ron leaving, and he wouldn't let anyone else leave. So we had to wait for the protest to be dismissed, and we won the race before it had to go. Yeah, well, Ron had a stroke at the age of 46.
I was 46 years of age at the time, and I was working at home on the farm at Yarradale. All of a sudden, I started to get a tingling in my arm and my face. I said to Lenny, you need to take me to hospital. She said, what for? I said, I think I might be having a stroke. And she said, well, what are you gonna do? I said, well, just take me down to Midland Hospital and we'll get it checked out. So I went back inside, grabbed a stubby out of the fridge, a cigarette packet, and I walked in and I got a cigarette in one hand and a stubby in the other. And Lenny said, "What the hell are you doing?" I said, "Don't worry about it." She said, "Don't worry about it. You're having a stroke and you're smoking and drinking." I said, "It's only one of these and it was not doing any damage." I said, "It's pacifying me." I get to hospital, the neurosurgeon, they brought him out in the middle of the night. He's checked me out, couldn't find anything wrong. Put me back in the bed, and half hour later, I'm paralyzed right down the right side. Arm, leg, everything, and I'm gone. So they shovel me back into a stroke ward where you can get treated and looked after better. The guy comes around at 6 or 7 o'clock in the morning. He said, "How you feeling?" I said, "Not too flash." He said, "Why?" I said, "I walked in here last night. What have you done to me?" He said, "You've had a stroke." I said, "That's fucking obvious." I said, "I'm 46 years of age. What causes a stroke? I'm 40." My grandmother had one, she was 70. I said, "That shit happens, but not at 46. He said, "Do you smoke?" I said, "I used to." He said, "How many?" I said, 60 a day. He said, "When did you give it up?" I said, "Yesterday."
Well, I think Ron wanted his legacy to be that people would remember him as a genuine, generous, honest person. I think, Ron wasn't, Ron certainly wasn't a person that, albeit that he was wealthy, he didn't portray that he was a wealthy person.
Hi, my name's Grant Burns. I had the greatest pleasure of my life working with Ron Sayers as a bloodstock advisor and he became a great friend of mine. Ron's impact on the racing industry was huge. He was a guy that we bred a lot of horses up at Yarradale that Ron had an interest in, and I'll just digress a little bit. And what he would do is, because he believed in his product and believed in the horses he bred, he would take them to auction or to market, whether that was down at the Magic Millions or whether it was at the Zone Farm Sale, and he would retain an interest in those horses. So he would keep 25 or 50% of every horse because he believed in them. He gave so much of his time. He was on committees. He's on the Perth Racing Board or committee, I should say. He was involved with when they were doing reports into the viability of selling TAB. Ron gave up a lot of time for all those things. He was always prepared to give so much more than he expected back. As you get to know Ron more, he's this amazing businessman, but truth of the matter is, he was most importantly a real family man. He'd do anything for his family and his friends, and an incredible mind. His mind could operate at a capacity that you don't see in many people. His ability to be able to manage many things at once. He's running a $1 billion company in Ausdrill at the time, and he'd ring me 4, 5, 6 times a day to talk about horses and what we can do here and buy this, buy that, sell this. His ability to manage all those things at the same time as a whole lot of other things in his life was quite incredible. The famous potato peeler. That story has been told many, many times, and it's an incredible thing, and it just epitomises what Ron's all about.
Now, the potato peeler. And I think everybody here has one.
Yep. So you do like your vegetables after all?
No.
Just potatoes?
Just potatoes. I got a phone call from a guy called John Kavner, who was a manager in Africa at the time. And I was going out to Ghana on the Monday. And he rang me, he said, "Look, Ron," he said, "can you do me a favour? Can you bring me over a few potato peelers?" I said, "What do you want potato peelers for?" I said, "You got staff, chefs, to do all your cooking and everything. Surely the Christ, they can peel your spuds." He said, no, we need potato peelers." I thought, "Oh, okay." So I go down to grab the wife and we go down the street and pulled into Bunnings. And I went into a shop called, not Bunnings, Woolworths, and said, "Where do you buy potato peelers?" They said, a shop called Things, the special shop inside the Woolworths supermarket. So I went in and had a look, and I said to the lady, I said, you got any potato peelers? She came out with a box. She had 15 potato peelers, different ones. Every one of them was different. I said, oh yeah. I said, how much are they? She said, a dollar each. I said, oh, I'll take the 15. So I bought the 15 potato peelers, went home, rang John up. I said, I've got some potato peelers. I said, but what I had done, I grabbed a handful of all these other ones. I'm going to work out which is the best one, and then we'll give that to you. He said, oh, okay. Oh, sorry. Walking out of Woolies, I walked past their stand where they had potato peelers, and they had a different one, so I bought that one as well.
Yeah.
Just an extra one to make the thing good. When I got home, that was the best potato peeler out of the whole 15. So I rang up the next morning because I bought it through Woolies in Sydney, and they gave me the company that was selling these potato peelers in Sydney. So I rang up and said, how many have you got? And they said, 10,000. I said, how much are they? They said, a dollar each. I said, I'll take the 10,000. So we took the 10,000 potato peelers home, and they went super. And let me tell you a story. With all the countries and places that Ausdrill has operated in, the amount of times I've been to a mining conference anywhere, and the amount of people are standing on the Ausdrill stand demanding potato peelers. So when you get your potato peelers home tonight, go and grab half a dozen new spuds and just try them, and I defy anyone to say they're not good enough.
I tell you, I use mine every day, I reckon. It's amazing. Every day I pull one out of the drawer. We've got the Ausdrill one, we've got the Yarradale stud one. He's duplicated them, and they are the best potato peel. Yeah, this year at the Magic Millions yearling sales, it's a big team effort, the Yarradale stud draft going down to the sale, and Yarradale have been one of the leading consigners of horses through the sales for a number of years now. And Ron's very proud of his team. Of course, Olivia, Ron's granddaughter, was part of that team working at the sale this year. And Olivia was walking one yearling through, a nice looking yearling, and Ron, in his wisdom, was sitting in the auction, decided he'd stand up and give Liv a wave.
And he goes bidding for 50,000, number 50, take your fives on, what do you say? And I got 50 on him this time. At 50,000, he goes bidding for 50,000. Well, he's on the market, he's going to be sold. No, Ron, 50,000. 50,000. He's just waving. 50,000. 50,000. He's the vendor. It's okay. 50,000.
So he was standing up in the auditorium waving. And the one thing you don't do, myself being an auctioneer, if you wave at an auction, you're going to end up buying a horse. So I was lucky enough to be the auctioneer that day. And I said to the bid spotters who called Ron's bid, I said, no, it's okay. He's just giving a wave or a nod to his granddaughter. So he always kept us on his toes, Ron. That was so typical of him.